stuff. But anyway, so my question to you again will be, how do we start this? And hopefully all of you now will say, draw a free body diagram. And then my follow-up question to you would be, free body diagram of what?
Point C.
Point C.
Very good. What is so great about point C?
It's where all the forces meet.
Okay, and we call that point?
Point of concurrence.
Excellent, Jaehyun. Okay, so here's my point C right here. And at this point, we need to be able to identify all the forces that are acting at this point. I'm going to start with the easiest one. And what would that easiest point be? I mean, easiest force be? What would be the easiest force to identify here?
The weight of the man in the chair.
Very good. It's the combined weight, right? And it goes straight down. And the combined weight is 200 pounds. Okay, and then let's take a look at your support cable ACB. Again, it starts from the, looks like from the picture, right? The second quadrant. Goes around the pulley at point C, and then it extends out to the first quadrant. Like so. And this is a tension, so it's already telling us that. So I'm going to put the sense pulling away from the point of concurrency. And I'm going to give it a name, and I'm going to call it tension ACB, just like in your problem statement. The only difference with these two segments of the same cable is the angle of inclination. We're given 30 degrees here and 10 degrees here. Then we have our second cable, which is the traction cable of CD. Again, in the picture, it kind of coincides with the left segment of the cable ACB. So I'm going to draw my traction cable, kind of coinciding. With my ACB. And it has the same angle of inclination of 30. And that's it. Our free body diagram is done. Then as usual, we're going to apply our equations of equilibrium so that the person will be rescued safely. So again, my condition is sum of the forces gotta be equal to zero. Starting with sum of the forces in the X equal to zero, I will start with your tension ACB in the first quadrant. It's being pulled to the right, so positive. At an angle of 10, so cosine of 10 degrees. And in the second quadrant, it's still the same cable, right? Same magnitude, but it's pulling to the left. So minus times cosine of 30. Then we have our traction cable, or so minus, times cosine of 30. And the sum of these three forces got equal to zero. But notice that ACB is just one cable, but we're looking at two segments of the cable. So they have to have the same magnitude. So we can combine the coefficients and we should get 0.1188 tension ACB minus tension CD times cosine of 30. And the sum is equal to zero. Again, I am stuck here because I have two unknowns. So let me just go ahead with my expression for substitution because this one is easy. And dividing cosine 30 by 0.1188, we get a coefficient of 7.2909 times T sub CD. And again, mathematically, we're stuck here. Let me scroll down. Our second equation, sum of forces in the y equal to zero. Again, I'm going to start from the first quadrant, and let me quickly go back to the free body diagram so we can look at it together, and then I'll come back. Okay, move too fast. So T sub ACB in the first quadrant is going up. T sub ACB and T sub CD in the second quadrant, they're both going up as well. The only thing that is going to be negative is your 200 pounds. So let me go back. Then write it here. Again, starting from the first quadrant. Again, ACB is just one continuous cable. The same, right? So I can combine those two. Okay, let me scroll up to where we have our ACB. So I have my, from the first equation, I have T sub ACB expressed in terms of CD. So I'm going to bring it down here and make the substitution. So I got 0.6736. I'm going to substitute here. 7.29. Now I have completely eliminated the unknown T sub ACB, replacing it with T sub CD. I can now solve for the tension in cable CD. Now I will allow you guys to do the rest of the math here and just give the final answer for T sub CD. Or maybe I will write this so we can continue to have our exercise on significant figures. So my calculator returns to me 36.9583 pounds for T sub CD. So using three significant figures, I get 37.0 pounds. By the way, on your quiz, you have to know how to use significant figures. If your significant figures are wrong, then I will mark it wrong. Okay. I need to scroll up and make one more substitution. Hello, my pen. 36.9583 pounds. And we get 269. And for the cable ACB, the magnitude works out to be 269 pounds. Let me scroll down. Can I put both in this? Okay, you guys can see both. Okay, are there any questions on this? My son says he needs help, but I told him I'm in class. Do you guys have any questions?
Nope.
Okay. Okay. Can you just give me a minute? My son is at the door. Sorry, guys. Let me see what he needs. Maybe he's having trouble with his computer again. Hold on. Give me like 1 minute. Sorry about that, guys, and thank you for letting me get off for a minute there. Okay, so if you guys are okay with this one, it wasn't that bad, right? I want us to take a look at 2.58. And typically, students have a problem with this one, not because it looks intimidating, but because of the unknowns that need to be determined here. But we've seen a problem similar to this before. So maybe we can use this as another math exercise. So here we have three cables, and it says that the maximum allowable tension is 600 newtons in cable AC and 750 newton in cable BC. So we're being told that AC here, we know the magnitude, and for BC, we know the magnitude. But it's asking, determine the maximum force P that can be applied at C, and then the corresponding angle of alpha. So again, it doesn't say equilibrium anywhere, but how do we know that this is supposed to be a problem of equilibrium?
Is it the tension?
Not necessarily the word tension, because we saw the word tension before, but we had another keyword, right? So tell us that. Okay, this one is a little different because it says the maximum allowable, right? That's something new. And you guys are gonna see something more like this, terms more and more, not so much in this class, but you're going to see more and more of this in your future engineering classes. So again, this is an equilibrium problem. And I said to you before, we can treat everything in this class as equilibrium. So we're going to start with our free body diagram. And coincidentally, I think, or maybe not, in your homework problems, all of your points of concurrency is labeled C. So that's going to be our point of concurrency right here. Okay, and let me start with the first quadrant. We're given the magnitude of this force, and I'm gonna call this T sub BC, T for tension, and BC for the labels that we were given, 750 newtons. And then this one is, what is this one? AC of 600 newtons. And then we have our force P, and we have unknown alpha here. But for the other two, we know their angles of inclination. Again, this is the free body diagram of point C. Okay, so once you have your free body diagram, you just have to follow your free body diagram in expressing your equations. Since we've done this multiple times, let me go through this one rather quickly, because I just want to focus on the math for this one. Starting from the first quadrant, I got 750 positive times cosine of 25 minus, which one is this, 600 times. Okay, so for the the first two forces, we know everything about them. It's the force P, but at least we know the sense of the force. So using the sense, it's definitely negative. P, unknown P, times cosine of alpha. Okay, so I'm going to, of course, combine the first two forces because everything is known about them. This is newtons, right? Okay, so I got P times cosine of alpha equal to 255.4668 newtons. Again, I got two unknowns in this one equation, P and the alpha. And even though the question says find P and then find alpha, to me, it doesn't matter which one you find first. It really depends on which mathematical method you apply. So I don't really care how you which one you find first, but I am stuck. Okay, so let me come back to this. And let's proceed to the second equation. Can I scroll down? Do you guys have that? Okay, silence meaning you, yes?
No, can you go back up right quick? All right, get on it.
Okay. Let me know, Ty, when you're Taiwana, when you're ready.
Okay, I'm good.
Okay, very good. So let's go down to our second equation. Okay, so again, starting from the first quadrant. Again, our P is unknown, but using its sense given, it's going to be minus P times sine of alpha. Okay, so similar to the first one, we can combine the first two forces and we should get P times sine of alpha equal to 741.2278 newtons. So if you, let me scroll back up. Let me see. Oh, no, I can't. I cannot show you both. But looking at this second equation, it looks very similar to the first one. So here is the math discussion that I wanted to have with you guys. So looking at these two, what can I use here to solve for P and the angle alpha? What can we use here? What have we used before in this class that is quite easy to use? It's time for you guys to talk.
Try to use a tangent.
Very good. Taiwana, I think that was Taiwana, right? Very good. We can combine the sine and the cosine and then replace them with tangent, right? So in order for us to do that, okay, I gotta move one equation to the other one, right? So what I've done is, and this is not the only way, so I'm going to find P from the first equation. Because notice that by doing so, I'm putting my cosine alpha in the denominator, and that's exactly how I want to keep it. So I got P equal to 255, like this. So I'm going to take this, take it down there, and substitute. I'm going to substitute so you guys are going to see it again. So for P, I'm going to replace it with 255 from above divided by cosine of alpha times sine of alpha. Don't forget that. Okay. Notice that I got cosine alpha divided into sine of alpha, which will give me tangent . Now I can move the other constant over to here and we get 2.9015. Newtons are canceled out. So alpha, taking the inverse tan of 2.9015, we should get 70.9833 degrees, or alpha is equal to 71.0 degrees. I think this method or this way is quite easy because we're so used to SOHCAHTOA, right? Okay, now that I have alpha, I gotta go back to either or of the two equations. It doesn't matter which one you use, but I gotta go back and make one more substitution and I should get, do I have space here? I'll just do it on this side. Since I have this one right here, maybe I can use that. I'll do it here on the same page. So I got P times sine of 71 degree and for P we should get 784 newtons. Okay. So that's the math that I wanted to go over with you guys, just in case. Any question on this before we continue?
Could you scroll up one slide?
Right here?
Yep. Thank you.
Okay.
I'm good.
Okay, very good. Anything else from the rest of you? Any other questions? Okay. So here comes the challenging part of this chapter. So we're getting into it. We'll get started today. And we'll do the examples in the next class. So most likely you should not, you won't be able to do your homework unless you want to get started, but you don't have to. Okay, so this is in section 2.4. The title says adding forces in space, but before we can add forces, just like in 2D plane, you gotta be able to resolve forces in space, right? So we're gonna have to do that first. Now for forces in space, we're gonna be covering two different methods. And the second method is what I shared with you guys in 2D, giving you a head start. So hopefully you guys will be able to see that. If you don't, I will remind you again. So hang on tight. You really gotta hang on tight with the 3D. Okay, so I'm gonna take this example force from your textbook, just straight out of your textbook. First of all, there are things that we need to be on the same page for. Look at your XYZ. If you're taking higher math, or in physics, your X, Y, Z may be oriented differently. If I were to ask you to draw X and Y coordinate system in 2D, you would say, this is your X moving to the right and moving up is your positive Y, right? So that is the same for both X and Y.